everyone. My name is Pauline Haycock, and I'm the celebrant here at Rainer's. And before we start, I just have a couple of announcements. And the first is, if you have a cell phone, would you please be so kind as to turn the ringer off for the duration of the service? And interment will be at a later time. And so you're invited to, and I'm sure you know, to please stay for refreshments immediately following the service. So at this time, I'd like to ask you to please stand as the family comes to join us.
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever.
Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, thank you for today. And Lord, I thank you for each one who has come today to show their support for Alex's family. And I ask that the words spoken here would be an encouragement to the family and to all of his friends as we take the time to honor Alex and to remember his life. This is such a difficult day, Lord. I just invite you to be here with us, bringing comfort at this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, on behalf of the family, I'd like to thank each and every one of you for your attendance here today. It's a tough day. It's a hard day. It's going to be an emotional day. But we're going to do a good job of saying goodbye to Alex. We have lots of lovely contributions today, and I think we're going to do a great job. So I know it is with very heavy hearts that you have gathered here today to celebrate the life of Alexander Carl Hornland. And family and friends, I am so very sorry that you must walk this road, and I do hope that today will be an encouragement to you. I know that Alex endeared himself to many of you here today and many that couldn't be here, and the loss of him is going to be felt for years to come. I would like to share a quote made by a very wise man who had experienced loss and struggle. His name was Zig Ziglar. And he said, though no one can go back and make a brand new start, anyone can start from now and make a brand new ending. He was talking about choices. Choices that we make at certain times in our lives. Choices that we make at crossroads in our lives. And family, it would seem to me that this quote would be a definition of your lives with Alex. On the day that you decided to adopt a baby from an orphanage in Romania, you were helping to make a brand new ending for Alex. Each parent in this room knows of the joy and excitement that we all feel as we prepare for the arrival of our children. Many spend days putting name combinations together to find just the right title for their little one. And we honor parents and grandparents with our choices, hoping that maybe our little one will share the best qualities of the dear one that we have named them after. We have hopes and dreams for our children. Who might they look like? What might they become? Then we begin to buy cribs and diapers in preparation for the big day. And from the very moment of their birth, we are holding them, caring for them, training them, and pouring love into their little lives. Dwain and Juli, there's no doubt in my mind that you as a family did those very things in preparation for giving Alex a brand new start once he became a member of your family. Never once in those early days did you make plans for a memorial service. It never crossed your mind that you would need to lovingly fashion an urn or write a eulogy. Yet here we are today, gathered and saddened by the ending of Alex's story. Family, I think you know that you did a good job. You strove to fulfill every hope and dream that you had for Alex, and you never gave up on him. And I think that you saw a reflection of that dream in just the fact that Alex always stayed in touch with you. He strove to keep a connection with you, his family. Tough times come to every family, not just families with adopted children. And it's how we manage those tough times that reveal our character. Now, let me give you an example from J.R.R. Tolkien's fictional novel, The Lord of the Rings. A simple, good-hearted hobbit by the name of Frodo Baggins is entrusted with a dangerous mission. I see that means something over here, guys. Together with a group called the Fellowship of the Ring, he must defeat the forces of evil by returning a magic gold ring to the fires of Mount Doom from which it was forged. Along the way, evil stalks Frodo. Battles are lost, friends die. And reflecting on such tragedies, Frodo confides in his wise friend Gandalf. And he says, "I wish this ring had never come to me. I wish that this had never happened." And Gandalf replies, "So do all who live to see such times. But that's not for them to decide. All you must decide is how to use the time that is given to you." Our Heavenly Father has asked us to care for others. In the Bible, the Apostle Paul tells the Corinthian church in 1 Corinthians 10:24, "Don't be concerned for your own good, but for the good of others." And then Jesus himself said in John 15, 12 and 13, "This is my command, that you love each other in the same way I have loved you. There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends." Family, you made a choice of how to use the time given to you by investing in Alex's life. That was a courageous decision all those years ago. So now we're going to take the time to hear about that life through eulogy, some words from friends, from some pictures on the screen. And so I'm going to ask Juli, Cathy, and Breanna to come now and share the eulogy.
I don't know how we're going to get through this, but we'll try. First of all, I want to thank you all so very much for coming. And I wanted to explain why we played in the garden. I can just hear Alex saying, "Why did you guys pick such a lame song?" It was one of Grandma Esther's favorite songs. She loved it. I'm confident that she's looking after him, so it was fitting that we join them together with one of her favorite songs. Alex, from the moment I first saw you, I knew that you were meant to be our son. I never gave birth to you, sweetie, but the bond we developed in the orphanage was unbreakable. I loved the trust I started to see in your eyes. I can't even begin to explain the emotion I felt the first time you cried when I put you back in your crib. I detested the conditions you had to struggle to survive to survive in for those 3 long months before I could get you out of the orphanage. I was in awe of the fight in you to stay alive. I will never forget the evening we drove through the gates of that horrible place, and you are ours forever. I was so happy when we arrived home, and your dad held you for the first time as his son. The love I saw in his eyes for you was breathtaking. We marveled at how quickly you adapted and thrived. You became so much more than seemed possible, given your traumatic start in life. You were so smart and athletic. You were such a gentle soul. I loved how kind you were with your nieces and nephews. You made each one feel so special whenever you were with them. I love the chaos you brought to our house and the enthusiasm you barreled through life with. I loved our camping trips. I loved that you made new friends within minutes of setting up camp. I loved watching you play hockey or soccer. I thought I would burst with pride at how good you were. I loved when you told me not very long ago that your favorite hockey trip was when you played for the Calgary Dinostars and you and I took the trailer to tournaments in Alberta and Vancouver. I loved the bond you had with your dad and the respect you had for him. Even later in life, when your struggles were the biggest, you always turned to him for answers. I loved that you never forgot to phone on our birthdays, wherever you were. I'd give anything for one more call from you. Words can't even begin to explain how much I loved you. Not flesh of my flesh, not bone of my bone, but still, miraculously, my own. Rest in peace, sweetie.
Alex and I, hi. We shared a secret. A secret smile the world will never understand. We had so many laughs, and we did so many ridiculous things. You would do anything for me and always wanted the best for me, your big sister. We had a bond that life's struggles could never erase. You are my baby brother, but I'm proud to say you are my best friend. You are always ready to protect me, to help me, or just to talk to me, that usually ended us laughing or being dumb, and no one really understood it. I pray so hard. You always knew how much I loved you, and always, always wanted the best for you, no matter where you were, and you were in a lot of different places. You were always, always in my heart. You had some big struggles later in life, but I could always depend on you as someone that wouldn't hesitate to stand up for me and fight for me, even if the other guy was twice your size. You would listen if I needed to cry. There's no one like my baby brother. Our lives and dreams have followed very different roads, but the bond we share always remains strong and so very important to me. Your happiness is a prayer I always said for you wherever you went. Of all the brothers I could have gotten, I'm so happy it turned out to be you, Alex. Despite our different choices, and we had a lot of different choices, we always remained close. There have been many times in the later years of our lives when we were in different worlds altogether. We are very, very different in many ways, but we are also very much the same. But the most important thought remains, I love you with my whole being. There are years behind us, full of the best memories we had, our separate lives. But in my heart, and yours too, I've always felt the love and bond we have. Perhaps words are not necessary because we both know what's there. But today I want to tell my family and friends how much I have and will always, always love you, Alex. Thanks for being my brother.
My sweet Alex, I wish we could go back in time and be best friends forever again. You're the best uncle and big brother I could have ever asked for. When Grandma and Grandpa met you, it was the luckiest day of all of our lives. Your joy and your light was placed exactly where it was needed. For years and years, you were my reason for smiling, my reason for laughing, and my most fierce protector. I'll quit loving you when country roads don't wind and curve. I'll quit loving you when cold beer doesn't quench your thirst. I'll quit loving you when there's no amen in a church. I'll quit loving you when the sun sets to the east and the sky turns evergreen. I hope you use that convincing charm of yours to talk your way into those pearly gates up there. The world has a little bit less sparkle without you in it. I love you.
Beautifully done, family. And now I'm supposed to be holding it together up here, but I need a tissue myself. So, two of Alex's friends, Billy and Tyler, have some things that they would like to share with us. That's tough to follow, guys, but come on. Come on, you can do it.
For those of you who don't know me, my name is Billy. I first met Alex when he was about 10 years old, when my family moved to Willowbrook. Alex's family lived kitty corner, tires. Chance, my younger brother, and Alex became almost inseparable. Brandon moved to town about a year later. I met Chance and Alex playing basketball and hockey. Together, they were much like the Three Stooges, always coming up with some plan of mischief to get into and how they were going to get away with it this time. That's usually about when I would come in halfway through these schemes and explain why their plan was foolish this time, not that it ever stopped them. Alex became like a little brother to me over these years. In their teenage years, many a time, they would end up back at our place, spending the remaining hours of the night waking up the rest of our household. I woke up on more than one occasion to Alex making craft dinner at 3 o'clock in the morning. Alex, always, or at least for as long as I can remember, always had a love for cheese and all things with cheese on it. I once watched him eat an entire brick of it in one sitting. This habit followed him through his adult life, because he was still doing it when he lived with me as an adult. Alex had a one-of-a-kind infectious laugh. He had a heart of gold, and he was always trying to make others laugh too. He almost seemed to have a sixth sense We could be living thousands of kilometers apart from each other, and I'd be having a bad day, and my phone would ding, and it would be Alex, with a video of him singing karaoke in his car, or a meme, or just something he knew would make my day. Alex was always there for me through thick and thin. I could always rely on him, whether I just needed a friend, a shoulder, a laugh, or help in any other way. He would always be there. And even though we haven't always lived in close proximity, whenever we got back together after a long absence, our friendship would always just pick up exactly where it left off. Alex really loved his random adventures. It didn't matter if it was going to the grocery store or a random trip to Edmonton. Leaving the house with Alex was always an adventure. Alex had a knack for finding shenanigans almost anywhere, and we always had fun together. Alex was a good person with a good heart who loved to be mischievous and have fun, and always went out of his way to include anybody who was willing to join in the fun. Whether it was a random adventure or just fun around the house, when Alex was around, we were always smiling.
For those of you that don't know me, I'm Tyler, or better known to Alex and most people as Frodo. Alex has been my best friend for about 14 years, since we met in 2008 trying out for the Junior Canucks. We became good friends right away, and we're always cruising around together, listening to music or finding something to get into on the weekends. Alex got me my first job in well testing, which he proceeded to quit a couple weeks later. A few years down the road, I was looking for work again. Once again, he got me a job well testing. Once again, he left shortly after. He was always on to some adventure. Alex has always had time for an adventure. Once he picked me up from camp with short notice, got one of the jobs that he'd quit on me on, and which I guess I quit that day too, we decided to go to Calgary for the Stampede. We drove through the night and got to Calgary, made it to the Stampede, spent about $80 and way too long trying to win my kid a big Pikachu stuffy. By the next day, all of our plans had changed, and we were off to Edmonton to go to the water sleds. Alex lived every day to the fullest, and when we were together, I did too. We chased waterfalls, golf courses, water slides, even a king-size mattress down the highway. I have so many stories that make me laugh every time. One of them, Alex was dog-sitting for Jazz, and her dog got out. It had to have been the hottest day that summer, and we were trying to chase this dog all up and down the train tracks. We finally called my auntie to come and help us out with another vehicle. At some point, we finally decided we needed a break, and we were right by Brown's, so we decided to go in and cool off and grab a drink. After a while, my auntie called. We had forgotten to let her know that we had stopped looking for the dog. The story has a happy ending, though. The dog did finally get home safely, but I don't think my auntie's ever forgiven us for leaving her out there. Almost all of our adventures were completely random and ended up with some of my favorite stories that I'll never forget. There's no one quite like Alex. He was unique, he stood out, and he stood up for what he believed in. Family meant everything to him, and I'm proud that he considered me family. Not just me, but my family was his family too. When he was coming back up this way, he was going through Kamloops, and my sister needed a ride. He, no hesitation, went and helped her out. When he would come from Grande Prairie to come and visit, he would usually stop in Poos and see my grandma and auntie before he'd even get to town to see me. He was the most loyal, stand-up friend. He had my back through thick and thin, and I had his. I'm really going to miss his random, pointless phone calls, daily Snapchats, and hundreds of hilarious memes. I love you, Alex. Thank you for being you.
Those are great stories. Thank you, guys. That was great. So we have a song, and it's a perfect song for today, because I can see in the stillness of the room, everybody's wishing and hoping for that you would have one more day with Alex. So let's have that song.
Last night I had a crazy dream. Wish was granted just for me. It could be for anything. I didn't ask for money or a mansion in Malibu. I simply wished for one more day with you. One more day. One more time. One more sunset. Maybe I'd be satisfied. But then again, I know what it would do. Leave me wishing still for one more day with you. First thing I do is pray for time to come. I'd unplug the telephone, keep the TV off. I'd hold you every second, say a million I love yous. That's what I'd do with one more day with you. One more day, one more time, one more sunset, maybe I'd be satisfied. But then again, I know what it would do. Leave me wishing still for one more day with you. One more day, one more time, one more sunset, maybe I'd be satisfied. But then again, I know what it would do. Leave me wishing still one more day. One more day. Keep me wishing still one more day with you.
I learned a lot of great things about Alex as I visited with his family. That he was athletic, that he was kind, that he loved his family, that he was smart, so very intelligent. I loved learning that he could speak French because school was too easy for him. That was a neat thing to learn about. But two of my favorite fun things that I learned about him. One was already mentioned today. First thing was his love of Coca-Cola, and the second was for macaroni and cheese. Such simple pleasures. Now, since he was such a great Coca-Cola consumer, I decided to find some Coke statistics to share with you. My favorite top three, probably boring to you, but I liked them. Coca-Cola claims its name is the second most understood word in the world, right behind okay. If every drop of Coke ever produced were placed in 8-ounce bottles and laid end to end, the bottles would reach the moon and back more than 2,000 times. Put another way, that would be one round trip a day for 5 years, 7 months, and 14 days. That's a lot of Coca-Cola. My husband probably had a hand in that. The active ingredient in Coke is phosphoric acid. Its pH is 2.8. I guess that means something. It will dissolve a nail in about 4 days. And in order to carry Coca-Cola syrup, the concentrate, the commercial truck must use the hazardous material placard reserved for highly corrosive materials. Isn't that great that you're drinking that? Got that in your fridge at home? Now let me tell you about macaroni and cheese. It has been around forever. It is believed that the first recipe ever recorded is from King Richard II's kitchen sometime in 1420. Thomas Jefferson, the third American president, is credited with bringing macaroni and cheese to North America in 1802 after having visited Italy and eaten some. He brought the recipe home. A Google search for macaroni and cheese recipes returns over 73 million results. And everybody, of course, has the best recipe. But Alex's favorite was Julie's. Mom Julie's. The dish is so popular that it even has its own holiday. Imagine that. It's unclear exactly who created it or when, but July 14th is National Macaroni and Cheese Day. In the U.S. Not here, I don't think so. But the Crayon King Crayola apparently has an affinity for the dish, just like Alex. In 1993, the company introduced a color called, you guessed it, macaroni and cheese. And it falls into the orange category, not the yellow. Guess it depends on what kind of cheese you use. But here's the best fact of all. Canada is the king of Kraft macaroni and cheese. The little blue box is more popular in Canada than anywhere else in the world. In fact, it's the official, unofficial, national dish. Here in Canada, we call it KD, Kraft Dinner, exactly. It's the most popular item of any kind bought in grocery stores here, and the average Canadian consumes 3.2 boxes a year. That's about 10 annual servings. That's 55% more than the average American gobbles up. Whew, we're good at macaroni and cheese, aren't we? For those of you who don't eat KD, just maybe Alex picked up your slack and helped us slide into our first place standing. That's pretty great. So let's continue to take a look back over Alex's life by watching the PowerPoint. Can we have those pictures, please?
Sunny days seem to hurt the most. I wear the pain like a heavy coat. I feel you everywhere I go. I see your smile, I see your face. I hear you laughing in the rain. I still can't believe you're gone. You died too young, like the story that hadn't just begun. But death tore the pages all away. God knows how I miss you. All the hell that I've been through, just knowing no one could take your place. Sometimes I wonder who you'd be today. When
Would you see the world? Would you chase your dreams? Settle down with a family. I wonder what would you name your babies. Some days the sky's so blue, I feel like I can talk to you. And I know it might sound crazy. It ain't fair you died too young, like a story that had just begun. But death tore the pages all away. God knows how I miss you. All the hell that I've been through, just knowing no one can take your place. Sometimes I wonder who you'd be today. Today, today, today. Sunny days seem to hurt the most. I wear the pain like a heavy coat. The only thing that gives me hope is I know I'll see you again someday. Someday, someday.
Okay. This pier and watch the sunset disappear. And drink a beer. Funny how the good ones go. Too soon, but the good Lord knows the reasons why, I guess. Sometimes a greater plan is kind of hard to understand. Right now it don't make sense. I can't make it all make sense. So I'm gonna sit right here on the edge of this pier. Watch the sunset disappear. And drink a beer. So long, my friend, until we meet again. This pier and watch the sunset disappear and drink a beer. Drink a beer. Drink a beer.
Well, here at the close of our service together, I'd like to share a hockey story with you. The story and the facts are taken from a website called the CanadianEncyclopedia.ca. We're recording today, and I need to make sure I do that. On January 28, 1943, near Kincardine, Ontario, a mother gave birth to a baby boy during a snowstorm while crossing Lake Huron in a horse-drawn sleigh on its way to the hospital. The community called the birth a miracle, and this baby boy was destined for great things. And what was his name? Anybody know? Paul Henderson. Of course, Henderson is best known for scoring the winning goal in the 1972 Soviet-Canadian hockey tournament called the Summit Series. There is a huge hockey history that should be explained as to the importance of the big game in 1972, because it would set up the reason for the excitement of Henderson's goal. But just know that from the very first major international hockey tournament in 1920, right through till 1953, Canada was the world leader. But then in 1954, the Soviet Union entered the world championships for the first time, and the Russians began a streak of 9 straight world and Olympic hockey golds. The Summit Series was proposed in the late 1960s, and both the Soviets and the Canadians were looking forward to the challenge. Since hockey is Canada's game, you can well imagine how shocked Canadian fans were when our team lost the opening game in Montreal. By the time Game 5 rolled around in Moscow, tensions were running high because Canada trailed the Soviets and would need 3 straight victories to claim the series. Still, there was enthusiastic support from some 3,000 Canadian fans who traveled to the Soviet Union, and tens of thousands of telegrams from home helped bolster the team as the series went on. Halfway through Game 8, the Soviets were ahead 5-3. But, led by Phil Esposito, Team Canada refused to concede defeat, and they managed to tie it up. With just 35 seconds left in the game, Henderson scored for Canada, and in the final 34 seconds, Canada held on for a 6-5 victory. As a side note, Paul Henderson actually scored the winning goal in each of the 3 final games, but his winning goal in the last game is regarded as one of the greatest sports moments of the last century. When you see pictures of that game, the sticks are raised, faces are beaming, and the fans are roaring. You can imagine. Well, family, yours and Alex's story is not so different from Paul Henderson and the winning Canadian team. Like Paul Henderson, Alex's birth and first 10 months were difficult, and he was destined for better things, thanks to the perseverance of you as a family. And even though Alex was a beloved member of your family, his inner struggles were a force to be reckoned with, much like the Russian hockey team. And reckon with them you did, and so did Alex. You've encountered people who couldn't understand Alex's struggles, and you have had people cheer him and you on as you have walked through life together. And even though his life has ended far, far too soon, it doesn't mean that you were defeated. You gave Alex an opportunity that many of those dear babies back in that Romanian orphanage never had. An opportunity to experience a family and friends that loved him and cheered for him. You gave him an opportunity to develop skills and learn new things. I hope the day will come when all of you, as you recognize your pain beginning to subside, that you'll be able to lift your sticks and cheer for Alex and the great, great years that he had. Let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for today. Thank you for the support and encouragement that is found here in this room. And I thank you, Father, that there's a lot of people praying for this family, and I ask that you would comfort them. I ask that you would lead and guide them in the decisions that need to be made at the unexpected passing of a loved one. And I thank you for Alex and the life that he had, the blessing that he was to so many, not just his family. And we thank you so much for the opportunity to be together today to celebrate his life. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And I'd like to close with a poem, if I can find it. It says, I'd like the memory of me to be a happy one. I'd like to leave an afterglow of smiles when life is done. I'd like to leave an echo whispering softly down the ways of happy times and laughing times and bright and summer days. I'd like the tears of those who grieve to dry before the sun of happy memories that I leave when life is done. There's no doubt about it, Alex has done that. So ladies and gentlemen, would you please rise for Alex?
You know there's a light that glows by the front door. Don't forget the keys under the mat. Childhood stars shine, always stay humble and kind. Go to church cause your mama says to. Visit grandpa every chance that you can. It won't be wasted time, always stay humble and kind. Hold the door, say please, say thank you. Don't steal, don't cheat, don't lie. I know you got mountains to climb, but always stay humble and kind. When the dreams you're dreaming come to you, when the work you put in is realized, let yourself feel the pride. Expect a free ride from no one. Don't hold a grudge or a chip, and here's why. Bitterness keeps you from flying. Always stay humble and kind. Know the difference between sleeping with someone and sleeping with someone you love. I love you, ain't no pick up line, so always stay humble and kind.